So hello friends, this is from Chambers and today we will be discussing the cardiovascular physiology, starting a new series of lectures on cardiovascular physiology. Okay. So starting with the very basics, we are going to study the physiology of the heart and the blood vessels. Whatever things are going to affect the blood vessels, whatever body mechanisms are controlling the blood vessels, be it a molecular level, be it a gross level, whatever, those we have to study in this topic. Second is in the heart itself, we have to study the physiology of heart also. And we have to study the CNS regulation. What is the CNS effect on the heart? We have to study what is the effect of the kidneys on the functioning of cardiovascular physiology. What is the effect of the acids and bases on the cardiovascular physiology? What is the effect of the some little drugs on the cardiovascular physiology? What is the effect of exercise? What is the effect of stress? What is the effect of happiness? What is the effect of sexual intercourse on your cardiovascular physiology? What is the effect of cycling? What is the effect of study on your cardiovascular physiology? These all things we have to discuss in great detail, because cardiovascular physiology forms the major part of your physiology curriculum. Okay, so I would be starting with very basics. Let me write like this. I'll be starting with very basics, that is circuits or circuitry of cardiovascular system. Circuitry of cardiovascular system. Just have a look here. Now, I want to give you a concept. The concept is that if I have a pump at home, this is my heart. First principle we have learned from the basics of physiology, that is, we need blood supply for each and every organ. At least 98-99% organs, we need a blood supply. That means all your organs should be connected to this pump. These pipelines should be connected. Pipelines should be going to everywhere. I'm not talking here anatomy. I'm here talking physiology. I have to speak in a physiological way. I can't speak anatomically. I can't start teaching you arteries. It's in the anatomy. I'll be teaching you arteries, cardiac anatomy in the anatomy portion. Here I'm concerned about physiology, okay? So that means the circuitry should be attached to every place so that you can supply the blood. And also you need to get the blood back from the organ so that you can oxygenate it. That means you should have a return also. You should have a return of the blood also. You are sending the blood, you are returning the blood. You are sending the blood, you are returning the blood. Okay. Now this circuit, we say, sir, we have heart. But physiologically, we are dividing the heart into right side and left side. We are dividing the heart into right side and left side. If I take this box, we are dividing the heart into right side and left side. And we call it left-sided heart also and right-sided heart. Now that will depend what is present in this right side heart. Right side heart is again two chamber, right atrium. Now chamber, wow. Logo is name is also chambers and this is also chamber. Okay, right ventricle. This is left atrium, left ventricle. Actually, this chamber is a very vast name. It's not about heart chambers. Okay, it has a very vast meaning. Someday I will explain it. Okay, so it has a very vast meaning. The logo itself has a vast meaning. It's not stethoscope. Okay. It is something else. Okay. So this right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, left ventricle. It is one of the meaning in stethoscope. Okay, by the way. So this pump system, if I divide this pump like this, so I am dividing this. I divide it as right side of the heart and I divide it as left side of the heart. In the brain, I am dividing. Okay. Just understanding the concept. Now, right-sided system, what is in between this system? what is connection between these two systems is the I take lungs here. Lungs is in between. Now, which connection of right side is connected to the lungs? It is the right ventricle. It is the right ventricle which is connected to your lungs. Right ventricle which is connected to your lungs. And this right ventricle is connected to your lungs by the pulmonary artery. Pulmonary artery. Okay. Now this lungs will be getting the blood. You have to get the blood to the left side. At least you remember, right side of the heart sends blood, ejects blood towards the pulmonary system. Normal physiology, we adults, as adults, not fetal circulation. We adults, when we have to eject the blood from the right side of the heart, it goes to the lungs. And if you, why you are sending it to the lungs? Because you want to oxygenate it, because lungs, you will have an exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide. So you oxygenate it, you increase the partial pressure of the oxygen at that point, bring the partial pressure of oxygen, that fully partialized, partial pressurized that oxygen, you bring it to the left side or right side. Should you bring it to the left side or right side? Now you want that blood to be sent to the body. So that means you should bring that to the side which will send it to the body. That is the function. So what is happening is from the lungs, you are getting the blood into the left atrium. You are getting the blood into the left atrium. Is it clear, friends? This is first a basic orientation you should know. Now, right ventricle sends blood to the lungs. From the lungs, the oxygenated blood is coming into the left atrium. It's coming into the left atrium. Okay. And this is your left ventricle. And I should keep a door here also, that I have a valve here. I have a valve. That's a right side valve or tricuspid valve. And this is mitral valve. This is mitral valve. Okay. Now see, guys. Where do you want to send? Now blood will come from the left atrium and will flow into the right left ventricle. From the right ventricle, do you want this to reach the body? Yes, sir. We want this to reach the body. I want to make it red because it's oxygenated. This is an oxygenated system. Oxygenated system, guys. Oxygenated system. Is it clear, friends? Are we understanding the meaning? Why are we drawing these two colors? Yeah. Now listen. This left ventricle has to send to the body. Has to send to the body. So this will send the blood to what things? This will send, I should draw a big aorta. The aorta is a very big muscular. Where is it sending? It is sending, first CNS is important. So I will say CNS, central nervous system. It will send to central nervous system. It will send to which? Coronary circulation, heart, coronary circulation. It will send to renal circulation. Renal circulation. It will send to skeletal muscles. It will send to skin. Okay. So these are the systems, normal systems. You know, there are so many systems. These are major systems where you will be getting this. Through the which arteries? What is these arteries called? Systemic arteries. Because you are sending the blood to the system. So systemic arteries. And now, veins will start collecting blood from them. Veins will start collecting blood from them. Okay. Make it like haphazardly. Okay. So veins will start getting blood from them, and then they will go into the which area? Right atrium. They will finish there in the right. How we will understand the circuit? So things will drain finally into the right atrium. And then again, from the right atrium, the things will come down and will go into the right ventricle. From the right ventricle, will go to the lungs for oxygenation. From the lungs, oxygenated, increased partial pressurized blood will return into the left atrium and will pass through this bicuspid, not mitral valve, and then is circulated in the aorta to all the systemic arteries. So here you should not write the systemic artery. This bigger one is an aorta. Bigger one is an aorta, which is splitting into, I hope you remember from the histology. That's why I taught you the cardiovascular histology first. So this is the aorta, and from the aorta, you are getting these systemic vessels. This is called circuits, heart circuits or circuitry of the heart. Now you saw, I hope you saw two circuits. You appreciated two circuits. The circuits were what circuits you appreciated? You appreciated a pulmonary circuit. This was a pulmonary circuit, guys. This was a pulmonary circuit. And this was a systemic circuit. So that means things were coming to return. Things are returning to me through this venous. Can I call it a venous return, guys? Yes, I will call it venous return. This is a venous return. And this is the cardiac output. You are giving the cardiac output from there. We're discussing everything in detail. Just giving you a circuitry of the heart, that what, how cardiovascular system is attached to the things. Okay. Now, friends, see. Just a second. What happened to this? Guys, are you able to see the screen? And is the recording happening? Yes, recording is happening. Okay. Recording is okay. Fine. Okay, friends. So, see, guys, talking about the circuitry, that means what idea you get if I talk the idea. If I take the idea in your brain, what idea you develop? What idea are you developing? The idea which I am developing after learning this is that, sir, cardiac output from the left side of the heart is going to the systemic blood flow. Cardiac output from the right side of the heart is going to the pulmonary outflow. So I say right side, this arrow, lungs. I call it pulmonary blood flow. First, you should understand the terminologies. Then you will enjoy the subject in the, you know, once you are studying, it even does not take time to study something because you are very well versed with the subjects, you know, with the terminologies. Okay. So pulmonary blood flow. If I'm saying left side is sending into the, system, then I say this is a systemic blood flow. Second thing I can, how we can speak this diagram is, if I tell you what is the direction of blood flow, please have a full, just write me the answer. What is the direction? Let me take this. So tell me one thing, what is the direction from the pulmonary artery? What is the direction of the blood from pulmonary artery. What is the direction? What is the direction of the blood from the pulmonary artery? Towards what? Towards what? I am saying, see, the words which I am using, I don't want you to tell me where it is coming. Just tell me lungs. Very nice. Where is the direction of the blood from the left atrium? What is the direction of the blood from the left atrium? What is the direction of the blood from the left atrium? Beautiful answer. It is left ventricle. It's left ventricle. Which valve? Which valve? Which valve is the left-sided valve between the left atrium and left ventricle? It is the mitral valve. Always speak mitral valve, okay? Which is bicuspid, but mitral is the word we use. Mitral valve, okay? What is the direction of the blood flow from the aorta? What is the direction of the blood flow from the aorta? Towards what? What is the direction of the blood flow from the aorta? Systemic vasculature. Beautiful answer. Systemic artery, systemic tissues, coronary circulation, splenic circulation, skeletal muscle, skin. What is the direction from the tissues? This is a tissue, for example. What is the direction of the blood flow from the tissues? From the tissues. From the tissues. What is the direction of the blood flow from the tissues? Beautiful answer, guys. Beautiful answer. It's towards the right atrium. It's towards the right atrium. It's towards the right atrium. What is the direction of the blood flow from the superior vena cava? Now you know superior vena cava collects blood from the upper parts of the body. Superior vena cava collects blood from the upper parts of the body and drains it in the right atrium. Drains it in the right atrium. Beautiful answer. So the direction of the blood flow is right atrium. Right atrium. Right atrium. Okay. Is it clear, friends? What is the direction of the blood flow from the right ventricle? What is the direction of blood flow from the right ventricle? What is the direction of blood flow from the right ventricle? Pulmonary vasculature. Pulmonary vasculature. Pulmonary system. Pulmonary arteries. Lungs. Can speak anything. What is the direction of the blood flow from the lungs? What is the direction of the blood flow from the lungs? Left atrium. Left atrium. Is it clear? Which direction should I take the blood flow if I have to oxygenate the blood? Which direction should I take the blood flow? Should it be from the right ventricle to the lungs or left ventricle to the lungs? Right ventricle to the lungs. Right ventricle to the lungs. Right ventricle to the lungs. Is it clear, friends? What is the direction of blood flow from the right ventricle? From the right ventricle. From the right ventricle. Towards the right ventricle and then towards the lungs. Exactly. What is draining towards the right atrium? Systemic venous circulation. Systemic venous circulation. Systemic venous circulation. Can we use my pointer to make the circulation? Okay. Can I use the pointer so that we get? No, it's not tough to understand. Just giving a review that your brain is, you know, oriented. Okay. Now right atrium. Yeah, you should speak now from right atrium. It's going into dash. You can use initial acronyms. It's going into, yeah, right ventricle, then goes into, the blood goes into, I'm not teaching right now whole of the cardiovascular, just giving you the basics. Going towards the lungs, from the lungs, you are draining the blood back into the, very nice, where draining the blood from which artery? Which vein? It is pulmonary vein. It's pulmonary vein. It's pulmonary vein. So I will be making like this. From the pulmonary vein, it drains into the left atrium. It drains into the left atrium. From the left atrium, passes through dash valve. Passes through dash valve. Mitral valve. Beautiful answer. From the left ventricle, it ejects the blood into the dash. It ejects blood into the dash, guys. Aorta. Aorta. Beautiful answer. From aorta, it goes into the systemic vasculature, systemic vasculature, systemic vasculature, systemic vasculature, guys. Is it clear? Goes into the systemic vasculature. See, guys, goes into the systemic vasculature, and then from the CNS, blood will go into the left ventricle, left atrium. From the coronary, goes into the left ventricle. From the renal circulation, goes into the left atrium. Goes into the left atrium. Are we clear? Then it drains into hair. Is it clear? This is for why so going so basic, because we have first year people. So for them, I am going very much basic. I should have this understanding that they are have this orientation. Okay. Now we have learned what are forming the components of this vasculature. What are forming the components of this vasculature? If I talk about the components of this vasculature, before going into that, I want to tell you which of the following. Okay, let me make like this. Let me make it clear like this. What hemodynamics? Who are the members of this vasculature? Who are the members of this vasculature? Number one. Arteries, isn't it? Arterioles and capillaries in the center. You can visualize in your brain. Capillaries in the center and venules coming out from that, collecting the blood and then giving me veins. I hope you have learned from the cardiovascular physiology, this cardiovascular histology. My videos are already on the YouTube. Okay, histology section, go to the playlist, click on the histology, check the cardiovascular histology. I have taught this thing in detail and there is no need of explaining it here again. Okay, just two things I will tell you. Which of the five you have to tell me is having the thick wall? Thickest, I can say. Arteries, and that too will be the aorta. Okay. Arteries have more of elastic tissue, more of smooth muscle, have high pressure. Which of the following is a high pressure system? This or this? One or five? Which is a high pressure system? Arteries is a high pressure system. Arteries is a high pressure system. Arteries is a not getting answers from everyone. Okay. It's okay. Fine. I'll be asking in the end. Don't worry on the audio. Don't worry. So veins. Veins will be low pressure system. We want to compare them. Veins are low pressure system. Okay. More amount of elastic tissue, more amount of smooth muscle. More amount of elastic tissue, more amount of smooth muscle. Veins, thin walled structures. Okay. The important point about arteries is that the volume, we have a term that is called, let me write a term for you, that's called stressed volume. What do we mean by stressed volume? Stressed volume means that volume of blood which is present in the arteries, the volume of blood which is present in the arteries, that is called as stressed volume. Please remember this definition. The volume of blood which is in the arterial system. So I can call this as this system. I can call as what I will call the system as, guys, the systems I will be calling stressed volume. So whenever I say you the stressed volume of blood, the stressed volume get high, you can understand that it's about arteries. Okay, fine. Now what is special about arterioles? Basically, arterioles are like faucets. Do you know faucets, guys? Faucets, you see, is some sort of a, you know, can say tap to control the flow. So who are doing this? It's the arterioles. Arterioles are behaving as resistances. Arteriole, please make a point on your copy. Arterioles are the highest resistance in the cardiovascular system. Arterioles have the site of highest resistance in the cardiovascular system is the arterioles. Okay, because you have more amount of autonomic nerve fibers there, isn't it? And arterial resistance is regulated by autonomic nervous system. Autonomic nervous system is more, the nerve fibers of the autonomic nervous system are more here, guys. Autonomic nervous system, which is controlling your blood pressure and your blood volumes, this is having more amounts of nerves. Arteriolar site is having more amounts of nerves. Are we clear? So arterioles, they will be having some receptors. Arterioles will be having some receptors, okay, which they will be, the body will talk to them. If the body has to talk to them, they have some receptors. Those I will be taking it separately. Okay. Now, second thing to remember is venules and capillary. I can give a special thing to you is venules and capillary. They have less amount of, means absent, not less amount, absent elastic tissue and smooth muscle. You have to remember, don't have elastic tissue, don't have smooth muscle. Okay. They will ask you a question. The question will be, there will be a question in your exam and also conceptual question. Which of the following is not having, now I will tell you one thing. Do we have two systems in the body? Sympathetic system, parasympathetic system. First year people, do we have two systems? One to deal with the emergency and one to deal with the normal things. And do you think that you should have a signal? For example, this is one transmitter. He has to talk to other. This is one policeman. If there is an emergency, he should tell this policeman, you have to take adequate measures. You have to take adequate measures to deal with the situation. So should you have some control? Should you have something here, a receptor, so that you can send something here and this receptor will activate and will deal with that stress? Yes, it should be definitely there. So that means you should have that system. Since let me first get from you people, what is the neurotransmitter who is controlling your sympathetic activity? It is the adrenaline, noradrenaline. Principal I'm talking about. Principal neurotransmitters are adrenaline, noradrenaline, which are dealing with the emergency situation. So can I say this region is having, can I say if this is dealing with the adrenergic system, this should be called as sympathetic adrenergic supply. Sympathetic adrenergic supply. Sympathetic adrenergic supply. Okay. Sympathetic adrenergic supply. So that means if I have sympathetic adrenergic supply, I will be responding to the noradrenaline, adrenaline, and will be doing that specific effect which I am supposed to do. Okay. So now they will ask you this question, which of the vessels is not having that sympathetic adrenergic supply? Capillaries again don't have sympathetic adrenergic supply. Meta-arterioles don't have sympathetic adrenergic supply. Pre-capillary sphincter, do we remember pre-capillary sphincter? Pre-capillary and arteriolar fossa is a different concept. Okay, don't merge them. I have taught you in cardiovascular histology, go to that section, listen to that section again and you will remember what I mean to say. Pre-capillary sphincter, meta-arterioles, capillary, that is cap. These all three don't have adrenergic sympathetic supply. So that means whatever vasoconstriction you will be doing, whatever vasodilatation you will be doing, you will be doing at the level of this vein and arteries only. Isn't it? You will be doing with them only. You are doing this vasoconstriction of vein, arteries, arterioles. Isn't it? Because they don't have supply. These are having the supply. They are having that antenna. They are having that antenna, that receptor. Okay. Okay. Is it clear, friends? So which receptors are present on arteries? Which receptors are present on arterioles, I should say, not arteries. I should say specifically arterioles. Okay, arterioles are small capillary. I have taught you small arterial vessels which have which antenna? They have alpha 1 antenna. What? Alpha 1 antenna. What, sir? Alpha 1 antenna on their surface. So it's a blood vessel. It has alpha 1 antenna here. Alpha 1 antenna. Alpha 1 antenna. Arterioles have alpha 1 antenna. Okay. Which blood vessels, which places have alpha 1 antenna for sympathetic activity? Which places? Skin. Your renal vasculature. These vessels will have more amount of alpha 1, alpha 1, alpha 1. And splanchnic also. Your gut and everything. This will have alpha 1. Splanchnic. Splanchnic. What about beta 2? Beta 2 is more present on the arterioles of your skeletal muscles. Arterioles of your skeletal muscles. Arterioles of your skeletal muscles have more amount of beta 2. Have more amount of beta 2. Are we clear? Skeletal muscles, the vessels in these skeletal muscles, arterioles have more amount of beta 2. The vessels in the skin, in the renal circulation, in the splanchnic circulation, they have more amount of alpha 1 adrenergic receptors. So I say them, they are alpha 1, not antenna. This should not be, this just I gave you an idea. The word is alpha 1 adrenergic receptors. Alpha 1 adrenergic receptors. Alpha 1 adrenergic receptors, then this should be called beta 2 adrenergic receptors. Beta 2 adrenergic receptors. Okay. Now see guys, parasympathetics more will be predominating your salivary gland. No, it's present in everywhere. Just giving you some examples. Okay. Parasympathetic, I always draw with green. Okay. So parasympathetics, I have salivary gland. I have to say something. That's why I'm taking these glands. I take GIT and I take genital erectile tissue. Genital erectile tissue. See, we have two processes happening in the body. One is erection. When the male genital organ becomes, achieves a height, that is, so that the ejaculation can happen. Okay. So if I'm taking the male penis, so this is the erection, this is the ejaculation. This is the erection, this is ejaculation. Ejaculation means delivering the semen, delivering the semen. So which of the following is a parasympathetic activity? So erection is a parasympathetic activity. Erection is a parasympathetic activity. Remember this concept. But ejaculation is sympathetic activity. Sympathetic. You have to remember this. Ejaculation is sympathetic activity. Parasympathetic activity is erection. Erection is a parasympathetic activity because erection has para. Erection has para. Erection has para. Erection has para. Sympathetic as ejaculation. Sympathetic as ejaculation. This is the concept. So these parasympathetics should be present. They should have the parasympathetic receptors so that they can, now fibers, so that they can talk. Okay. They can let them tell that what is the situation. Easy. Now, which of the following five So out of these five, which of the following is having the largest total cross-sectional surface area? It's the capillaries. Remember this fact, guys. Capillaries is having the largest total cross-sectional area. Capillaries, guys. Capillaries. Because they are so much that the total area will increase. They are so much that they are distributed to every place. Isn't it? So capillaries have the total cross area more. Okay, and these capillaries are the sites where you will be having exchange of materials between the cell. So whatever things you bought, those small places, who can reach those small places? It's capillaries, small, minute capillaries. You won't see them in dissection. Okay, you just see some threads or something. They're so small, can't see capillaries. They're inside the tissue. Okay. Now, if I tell you a concept that if I join all the capillaries, if I join all the capillaries, what will they form? If I join all capillaries, what will they give me? They will give me venules. They will give me venules. If I join all these capillaries, I will get what? Venules. I will get venules, guys. Okay. So venules are formed from, if you collect all capillaries, if you collect all capillaries, you will be getting what? Venules. You will be getting venules. Okay. Talking about veins. Veins have which receptors, sir? You did not tell us. Veins have alpha 1. Veins have alpha 1. I have to teach you every receptor. It's not that only alpha 1 is there. Okay. But here just letting you write some points physiologically. That remember, alpha 1 is for veins. Alpha 1 is for veins. Okay, guys? Alpha 1 is for veins. Fine? Clear? Okay. I want you to write a point in your copy. I want you to write a point in your copy, a star point, that is precapillary sphincters are controlled by number 1, oxygen concentration, number 2, local metabolites. Those precapillary sphincters, I hope you remember, they're controlling your what? Oxygen. Which is controlling them? Oxygen concentration where? In the tissues. Whatever is the concentration of oxygen in the tissues, they will be guiding this precapillary sphincter. They will be guiding this precapillary sphincter, guys. And also the local enzymatic reaction products which have been produced, they will be also regulating these precapillary sphincters. Okay. Now, distribution of blood. If I talk about the distribution of blood, I can write like this. If I say blood distribution, see, where is the blood more, or where is this, you have to remember. Okay. I have to understand also. See, what was the cross-sectional area? The total cross-sectional area. If I take all the capillaries, if I take all the small, small capillaries, this becomes the total cross-sectional area. This becomes the total cross-sectional area. For you, these are minute, but see how many millions and trillions they are present. Okay. And consider, can you consider it equal to an aorta? No, sir. How is it possible? Equal to one aorta, how is it possible? There are so many capillaries. How can you say? So that's why we are saying cross-sectional area is minimum for aorta. Cross-sectional area is minimum for aorta, but it is maximum for capillaries. Just capillary mass, maximum for capillaries. Is it clear? Is it clear? Which of the following five vessels? Which of the following five vessels? Let me really, remove this dirt here, isn't it? I write so much because I keep telling with my mind, isn't it? That's why I am using this another pen, which is getting, removed also at the same time. Okay. Which of the following, let me take this also. Which of the following, okay, let us take these five. Which of the following is having highest amount of maximum, not amount should not be used. I think percentage should be used. Which is having the maximum percentage of blood? It is the veins. Veins are known as dash vessels, capacitance vessels. Veins are known as capacitance vessels. So capacitance means they have the capacity to hold the blood. So that's why they are called capacitance vessels. So veins have maximum percentage of blood. Veins in your body, if you see your where you want to see the more blood, it will be in the venular side. It will be on the venous side. And minimum amount of blood, where is the minimum percentage of blood? It is in the arterioles. Arterioles have the minimum percentage of blood, guys. This is having the maximum. So maximum veins, minimum arterioles. They are just resistance vessels. Because maximum resistance is happening at the arteriole. And it is the task of the arteriole is not to store the blood, but it is to regulate, to distribute that blood to that part of the tissue. To that part of the tissue, you want to regulate, you want to build a resistance so that you can control. You have to control the blood flow. It's not that blood comes with a jerk and leaves the jerk. Whether the blood is required at that moment or not, that is also a factor. The blood is required at that point, at that region or not, that will control the blood flow to that region. How we will understand? So it's important that a capillary, that an arteriole is present so that it can develop a resistance and it can tell that blood flow whether I can allow you inside that tissue or not. So it is depending on this arteriole that whether it will let this blood come to this region or not. Are we clear? So your distribution, if you tell me, sir, what to write, write one point. Distribution of blood flow is done by distribution of blood flow to the organs, to all the organs is done by their respective arterioles, by their respective arterioles, guys. Okay. Sir, where is the maximum amount of blood present? It's in the peripheral circulation. Sir, which region, sir? Now, they will be asking you, is it more in the vein or venule? What you will write? Is it more in the vein or venule? Now you said, sir, veins. Okay. Veins have, it's in the venules. Okay. Venules have 25%. This has 21%. Okay. So you don't have to remember the percentages. Just remember more on the venous side. And if that they ask more depth, venules. Which is having the minimum? Which number should I give to the minimum out of the five? Which minimum percentage of blood? Which region should I give? It's the arterioles. It's the arterioles. If I go into the circuit, guys, now the approaches are changing. You know, it's my approach, how I teach. I don't know about others, but this is the approach that we should take for your physiology so that you can get a good idea of what is happening. So out of these, see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Or if you take these all chambers 1 and 2 as 1, you take it as 1. And I tell you, I have 4 things in my hand. What, guys? I have 4 things in my hand. I have a pulmonary artery. I have a pulmonary vein. I have 4 chambers of the heart. And I have a pulmonary artery, pulmonary vein, 4 chambers of the heart. Okay, pulmonary artery, pulmonary vein. And I should take lungs also. Okay, let me take lungs, pulmonary, capillary. I take lung, pulmonary, capillary. I take this 1, 2, 3, and 4. Means these two chambers I took as 1, 2, 3, and 4. Which of the following will be having more amount percentage of blood? Which of the following will be having more percentage of blood, guys? It will be definitely in the heart chambers. It will be definitely in the heart chambers, guys. Okay, please write on the notebook. It will be in the heart chambers. Are we writing? Okay, let me write for you. Heart chambers. Out of these, I'm comparing all of them. Okay, I'm comparing them. Heart chambers will be having. Okay, is it clear? Out of them. It's not so much difference. Actually, I will, to go more specific, if you want me, I will say, if this is the pulmonary vein, and you know, chambers of the heart, they have approximately 7% of blood. They have approximately 7% of blood. And if I talk about the pulmonary artery, they will be having some 3 or 4. So pulmonary artery, pulmonary capillaries, 3, 4, something like that. Okay. Is it clear? The blood, whatever blood is present. Okay. Now, physiologically, we had learned in the cardiovascular histology that we were dividing the vessels on the basis of those diameters. One was the medium-sized vessels, one was the large-sized vessels, one was the small capillaries. But physiologically, we are dividing the blood vessels into 5 types, guys. How many? How many, guys? I should have an answer from you. How many physiological type of vessels? Physiological, 5. Remember the 5 and give me 5 what? Give me 5. Give me 5, guys. Give me 5. with your palm open. Okay. Is it clear? Cute people, is it clear? Every cute people, is it clear? Every cute people. Okay. Now we have to remember this five, physiological five, guys. What? Physiological five. Physiological five. Very nice answer. Artery, arterioles, veins. Okay. But I want to discuss them in my way, physiologically. What is the name? This is not the name. This is the histological words which you use. This is again histological. They will come in that. But you talked histologically again. Okay. That's why we are letting you want you to don't preoccupy any thought. You are preoccupying it. That's why we told you in the beginning, make your brain clear. Okay. So write five. Number one, wind castle vessel. This will disappear. See how? Gone. Okay, let us write it. Wind castle vessel. Number two, resistance vessels. Number three, exchange vessels. Number four, capacitance vessels. Number five, shunt vessels. Okay, friends, wind castle vessel. Resistance vessel, exchange vessels, then capacitance vessels, and then shunt vessels. Shunt. A wind castle vessel, what things come in it? Aorta and major arteries. Aorta and major arteries are in this wind castle vessel. Arterioles come in resistance vessels. Exchange vessels, we have capillaries. Capacitance vessels, we have veins, or you can also include all your venous system in it. Capacitance, because we said in the venous system we have more amount of blood. Shunt vessels. Shunt means we are shunting something directly. We are not going here, or we are doing something that we had a region, this A region. I have an A region and I have this vessel and I have this vessel. What I do is I shunt. I shunt this area and reach here. Okay. So this is called direct AV connections. AV anastomosis. Anastomosis means there is a link, a connection between the two luminal structures, between the two luminal structures that what we are using. It's not, we know we have two definitions. We have two definitions according to, if I talk about the sinuses, if I talk about the fistula. So I should not speak here the two lumen. I can say that the two arteries, the two capillaries, if they are joining, okay, by a shunt, okay, the two vasculated, two circulations. Wind castle effect, aorta and major arteries. I told you why they are called wind castle vessels, because they exhibit an effect that is called wind castle effect. They do an effect that is wind castle effect. We will be learning it. It's just for right now. Just remember, it is a elastic recoil effect. It's an elastic recoil effect. Okay, it's an elastic effect, okay, which is happening when your blood vessel gets stretched. If you stretch this aorta, it will with a sudden jerk, it will recoil, okay, it will recoil back. I'll be teaching you this, don't worry, just right now we have to remain, topic specific, otherwise I go into so depth that, no way to come back. Now this wind castle effect is the elastic recoiling effect. which is happening when you are stretching the aortic walls. Okay. Now this resistance vessels, that is the arterioles, they have beside their more amount of elastic tissue, you know, when they are more amount of smooth muscles. Okay. So that means their wall thickness, can I say physiologically, their wall thickness by lumen ratio is more. Can I say their wall thickness by lumen ratio is more if they have more amount of smooth muscles? If they have more amount of smooth muscles, that means they have the ratio, the wall thickness to lumen ratio is more. Wall thickness to lumen ratio is more. Excuse me. Exchange vessels means capillaries. Okay. Exchange vessels means capillaries. Okay. Now, who is controlling these exchange vessels? Is there any nerve supply? Is there any nerve supply to these exchange vessels? No, sir. They don't have innervation. They are not innervated. And the control of the capillaries, the exchange vessels, these capillaries are be controlled. If they don't have innervation, God gave them. If they didn't give them, no nerves, but he gave them something special. That is precapillary sphincter. So that they can regulate the blood flow. Capacitance vessels, I don't think it needs more explanation. It's, you know, the capacitance vessel stores more amount of blood, venous side. Okay. Shunt vessels, AV, they are sometimes also called those glomus structures. This AV anastomosis is having very much thick wall and the nerve supply is more. The nerve supply is more richly innervated, we call it. Richly innervated, guys. Richly innervated. You know your fingertips, this has more amount of AV anastomosis. Do you recognize this structure? What is this structure, guys? Very nice. So it is earlobes. So your earlobe is having what did I make? This is called in some languages jhumka, isn't it? And if she is a female, then she becomes jhumki. This becomes jhumki, isn't it? She becomes jhumki. Okay. So this is the concept you have to remember, guys. Okay. Sir, you said which is having the highest wall thickness is the resistance vessels. Then opposite should be true. Your vena cava. Remember a point, guys. Your vena cava is having the lowest vena cava because you don't have more amount of smooth muscles. So you should have a vena cava. Should have a lowest wall thickness to lumen ratio. Do we understand this wall thickness and lumen ratio, guys? This is wall thickness. This is the lumen. If I inverse this, this becomes this. And this is the lumen of this. So if I have more of these smooth muscle cells, I will be having the lumen will start getting narrow. But vena cava has low wall thickness to lumen ratio. Low wall thickness to lumen ratio. Are we clear? Now, I want you to remember in the cardiovascular system, three circles. This is how I learn it. Okay. I remember cardiovascular system. If I want to become a heart surgeon, cardiovascular and thoracic surgeon, I have to work on these principles. What is the principle? Pressure, flow, resistance. Pressure, flow, resistance. What? From today onwards, what you will start speaking? what you will speak from today once we read any hemodynamic disorder. What? Pressure, flow, resistance, guys. What? What we have to remember? Please repeat with me. Please speak to yourself. Speak it 5 times to yourself. And when you are done, I will wait for you. Speak it for 5 times with you in one go. No, don't say PFR. Don't say PFR. Say it slowly. Pressure, flow, resistance. Pressure, flow, not PFR. You will get confused. I want a full sentence for you. You say with yourself. Don't say with me. Okay. Easily say. Easily. Understand. Make your brain understand that these terms I have to remember. Second year people, are we clear? Third year people, the seniors. Where are the seniors, guys? Have we drawn the 3 circles on the notebook? Use it for any hemodynamic disorder. That's how I study any hemodynamic disorder. Till this moment, whatever hemodynamic diseases I have studied, I always study them on the basis of pressure, flow, resistance. Pressure, flow, resistance. Pressure, flow, resistance. As much as you practice, the more sharp you become. Pressure, flow, resistance. Okay. This is clear. This is clear, guys. Easy. Is till now, is there any doubt? Can we draw this relationship, guys? Can we draw this relationship? I'll show you what. I just want to first understand, are we clear with this system? Just making a many capillaries I'm making, okay? Many capillaries I'm making. Okay. So I've tried to draw the capillaries and now I'm on the venous side. Is it clear, friends? This is on my vena cable side. This is my arteriolar side, guys. This is my aorta, for example. And aorta broke into arteries. Aorta broke into arteries. I've taught you already, guys. Arteries broke into arterioles. Arteries broke into arterioles. And then they split into capillaries. This all purplish. This all purplish color is capillaries, guys. This all region is the capillary region. Capillary. And this is the venules. Now capillaries will join to form venules. Capillaries will join to form venules. And venules will join to form veins. These are veins. Now we have veins. And these veins will now draw the blood towards the vena cava in the right side of the heart. Are we clear? This was the left side of the heart. Are we oriented? I will draw this picture only once because I hope you remember this for your. So left side, aorta, aorta, arteries, arterioles, capillary, venules, veins, vena cava. This should be on the fingertip and then right in the right heart. Okay. Is it clear? Okay. Now see, friends, did we understood in the histology that we had three types of capillaries? We had continuous capillary, we had fenestrated capillary, we had sinusoidal capillary. If you now tell me one concept, if you do grave fenestrations, if you do grave, you go to that level, you make so many holes that you destroy even what fenestrations, what you will get? Sinusoidal. Sinusoidal is the highest form of fenestrated capillary. Sinusoidal capillaries are the highest form of fenestrated capillaries. Your continuous capillaries have those tight junctions. Like what places do we find the continuous capillaries? Who can tell me? Brain, spinal cord, retina. Okay. And by the way, we know from the concepts of capillary that brain capillaries have the least permeability. They want to form that blood-brain barrier. Talking about the fenestrations, we have more amount of fenestrated capillaries in the kidney, in the peritubular capillary, in the intestinal mucosa, endocrine glands, circumventricular organs. I will be teaching you in the neurology, the circumventricular organs. Okay. We have more amounts of fenestrated capillaries. We have. Why I'm going so fast? Because we have talked about this great detail in the cardiovascular histology. You have to go to that lecture. And we said, you know, synovial joint, we have more amount of fenestrated capillaries, connective tissue, choroid plexus, nerve epineurium, glomerulus. So all has the fenestrations. Sinusoidal, we said the best example, liver. Then we said spleen, bone marrow. Okay. And liver allows everyone to come. That's how God basically decorated this organ. The liver is decorated organ. Do you know it? It's a decorated, very nicely decorated. Why, sir? Because it contains more amounts of, it's permeable to everyone. It's a welcome guy. It's a welcome guy like me. Anyone can come and study. Why? Because this liver, he wants to destroy the pathogens. He wants to destroy the metabolites. That's why he's welcoming. He has to do, he's the busiest person. He wants to work his best so that the body keeps functioning at its best. Is it clear? So you have spleen also is working hard. You have bone marrows. And pretty shame on the people who don't work. You see, your organs are working so much that they are trying to make you stable. If you get a single toxin in your blood circulation, you will die in a bad way. If you get a single toxemia, you will be dying in a painful manner. Okay, friends. So it's the beauty of this liver, this organ, that it's, by the way, there were also some parasites. We discussed that we have some, they were contracting those mesangial cells. They were in the extracellular matrix. I hope we remember that. So remember those things also. Okay. Now I want to give you an example. There is a nice example which we have to understand. That is of a pipe. I will end this discussion on this topic. We have a pipe here. This is a pipe. I should draw it to the lumen. Okay. This is a pipe. I have a pipe in my hand. Okay. What three things we remember about hemodynamics? This is flow. We are talking about hemodynamics. That is flow, the dynamic flow. We're talking about the way the things are flowing. That is hemodynamics. What three things I have told you to learn? Pressure, flow, resistance. Pressure, flow, resistance. Fine. Can I mark this as P1 and P2? Why? Wrong. I should not write like this. I should first tell you, if I put some sort of resistance here, if I put any sort of resistance, I hope you can understand. For example, you have, while you are gardening or while you're washing your car, you are putting some pressure here. Okay. That's what you are making a resistance. What will happen to the pressure from the A side? Beautiful answer. What? Because I want to first tell you, things are coming like this. Things are coming like this, okay? The flow is coming like this. And flow is leaving from this side. Now tell me one thing. Can I say upstream pressure goes up? Upstream pressure goes up. Can I say downstream pressure goes down? Are we clear with this terminology first? This is the professional terminology we use in physiology, which you are not told. It's important to understand that in this sense only. Upstream pressure goes up, downstream pressure goes down once you are increasing the resistance. Upstream pressure goes up, downstream pressure goes down once you are increasing the resistance. Upstream pressure goes up, downstream pressure goes down when you are increasing this resistance. Are we clear? Now I will be writing. Can I write it as P1? Can I write it as P2? Okay. Is it clear? Guys, I want you to understand it that way only. What I mean to say. Okay. Now, can I give you a scenario, a clinical scenario here? Can I say I am giving you a vasoconstrictor? I give you a vasoconstrictor. Can I say on giving the vasoconstrictor, I don't know why I love medicine. On giving a vasoconstrictor, upstream pressure goes up, downstream pressure goes down. Can I say on using the vasoconstrictor, alpha 1 agonist, can I say it is increasing the upstream pressure goes up, downstream pressure goes down. Can I say like this? Upstream pressure goes up, downstream pressure goes down. Yeah. Next story will be continuing tomorrow. Okay. Next story will be continuing tomorrow. I hope you have enjoyed this lecture. Please subscribe to this channel. I will be uploading more videos on this, and mainly not uploading more videos, to be very much truthful. I want to put these all videos in the app. Okay. Again, I want to speak that app when it comes into, you know, in the market. You can only access it. It's free of cost. It's free of cost, free education, nothing else. It's free education. Every topic of medical science is available on it. It's basically a Netflix. So see, I am drawing a blood vessel. Now I draw this blood vessel and I am putting a vasoconstrictor here. Now you tell me which pressure will go up. Upstream pressure or downstream pressure? P1 will increase or P2 will increase? Beautiful answer. So upstream pressure goes up and downstream pressure goes down. Upstream pressure goes up, downstream pressure goes down, guys. Is it clear? Is it clear, friends? So that's why we have a relation for flow. Resistance. We have an equation that is delta P is equal to Q into R. Delta P is equal to Q into R. You have to remember this, guys. This is basically the, we use it in the Poisson equation, okay? Q is equal to P1 minus P2 divided by R. You have to remember that. I will be teaching you that, okay? The pressure differences, whatever be the pressure change. See, delta P, you can use delta P is equal to P1 minus P2. Simple mathematics, guys. Simple mathematics, elementary 6 LKG. P1 minus P2 is equal to Q into R. If I want to calculate the Q, Q is the flow. So first I will tell you Q is flow. R is resistance, P is pressure. I hope you understand. So Q is equal to P1 minus P2 divided by R. This is the Poisson equation. What was the spelling, by the way? Poisuil. Pois, it was not from V, it was U, I think. So, Poisson equation, isn't it? Poisson. Okay, so this is what you have to remember, guys. Okay, so thank you very much again. This is again, thank you very much, and see you all tomorrow in the next class. Please remember this equation, and we will see you soon tomorrow. Bye bye. Take care.